Good morning, everyone. It's good to have you here, whether you're online or in person. We actually have a working connection today for our live stream, for which we're grateful. We do want to note that this is a Communion Sunday, so those of you who are at home, if you wish to participate from home, you may prepare either a piece of bread or a cracker and either grape juice or water, and you can participate in our communion service late in the service. I also need to announce that with the uptick in cases in Henry County, we are under the substantial transmission level, which means that vaccinated as well as unvaccinated persons are to be masking indoors. So starting next Sunday, we're going to start wearing masks again. That's the only guidance we've been given at this time. It shouldn't interfere with anything else, but we are to wear masks starting next Sunday. We really should have today, but how do we let you know? So starting next week, we'll have to wear masks again in worship until the rate starts dropping again. So let us begin our time of worship with number 421, Make Me a Captive Lord, if you would stand. And enriched in this time of praise and celebration. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So, anyone here with a birthday or anniversary to celebrate this week? I'm not seeing anyone. Well, from our courier, on Friday, it was Thad Bielema and Diane Edmonds' birthday, and yesterday was Colton Causal. Tuesday is Cheryl Stones, and Thursday is Julie Dockstead. So we have several birthdays coming up. So make a point of wishing well to all of those that you know. We turn to our joys and concerns. In addition to those that are printed, we continue prayers for Bernie Powell, who is a friend of Barb Newman's, brother and sister-in-law. She is still in the final stages of cancer and is now in hospice care. And so prayers that she will move to the next life at the right time and with the least amount of pain. We have asked Michelle Faulkner if that's just to pray for a relative of hers, John Dobb, who was in a dirt bike accident. So we want to pray for him. Our schools and administrators and superintendents and all those who are making decisions about the upcoming school year, both locally and, you know, around the nation, all those decisions are being made. So we want to pray for all of them. I think that's all the updates I have today. So let us be in prayer. Oh, one other. Remember the Roberts family. Jim's funeral service is tomorrow. It's a private family and by invitation only graveside service, but the service is tomorrow at 11 o'clock. So be in prayer support for the family. So let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this day. We are struggling again with what the COVID spread is doing and how we are to respond. We are confused, we're frustrated, and we just want to get back to life as normal. Give us the patience we need to sort through it all and do the best we can to keep not only ourselves, but our neighbors safe as well. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for those who mourn, especially the Roberts family, as they will have their celebration of Jim's life tomorrow. Help all who are going through loss and trying to find their way forward one day at a time, one step at a time, to know that you love them and so do we. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for Bernie as she comes to the end of life. We pray that you will relieve her from pain and discomfort, that you will make her transition as easy as possible. And we pray that all her family and loved ones are ready to say farewell for now and until we meet again in the heavenly realm. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for John Dobb as he recovers from his accident. We're so thankful for the way in which Brian Jones is recovering from his. And we pray that everyone who is undergoing surgeries and recoveries from accidents, fighting diseases, that you will give them all the healing that you feel is needed. And may you encourage us to reach out our hands and arms and words and prayers of comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. As we prepare for a new school year to start, some school systems are starting as early as tomorrow. We pray that with the increased COVID cases, that you will help everyone make the wisest decisions that they can and provide the best education possible. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We come to you now in silence to offer you our personal joys and concerns. pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And now our Old Testament reading from Psalm 51 will be read by Sandy.
Good morning. For those of you that would like to follow along, you'll find it in page 889 of the Pew Bible. I will be reading from a New English, the New International Version, so it'll be a little bit different. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful at the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the innermost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all of my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You may remain seated, but let us join in the glory of God. Well, the psalm that Sandy just read to us was written by King David when there was something wrong with his heart. But it wasn't something a stethoscope could find. What was wrong with his heart was that he had done wrong things to people and had broken his relationship with God in doing it. He had done things that harmed others. He had kind of stolen another man's wife from him, and then he made sure that he died in the field of battle. So he did some bad things, didn't he? And that put his heart, not his physical heart, but his spiritual heart, in a sick place. So he needed to ask for forgiveness. And we're going to hear in a little bit, he wrote some of it in that psalm. We're also going to hear about it in a minute from the historians who wrote about that time. But he needed to get things fixed. And the best way to do that is to go to God and ask forgiveness. And then after you do that, to go to the people you've harmed and ask forgiveness of them. That's sometimes hard, isn't it? Do you find it hard to say, I'm sorry? I sometimes do. So I'm glad you don't. That's wonderful that you don't. But I sometimes struggle with that. Sometimes I feel embarrassed that I have to say I'm sorry when I've done something wrong. And so sometimes it's kind of tough to do. And sometimes you think that, you know, if you go back and say you're sorry, you're just going to make people feel bad all over again. And so then you have an excuse to not say I'm sorry. But we need to. We need to do that. But we also need to start with God and get things right with God so that our spiritual heart is in the right place because it's tuned into God again. And then that keeps us from doing bad things again. So we're going to ask God to look at what's in our heart and help make it clean, just as David asked that God make his heart clean again. Okay? So let us pray. Dear Father, we know that you can see what is in our heart, and we know that there are some things there that shouldn't be there. Create a clean heart in us, oh God, just like you did for David. Amen. All right. And now we are going to turn to how the history book of 2 Samuel records what happens with David and his spiritual advisor is Nathan, and he comes to David to try to point out how wrong David had been. So we're going to pick up the story in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 26. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. When the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. Nathan came to him and said to him, there are two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought. He brought it up, and it grew up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie on his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come with him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives, and gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this word for us today. It's a sad word. It is a time of great evil having happened. But we pray that you will help us to understand what we can learn from it and how we can prevent from doing the same thing or very similar thing. May the meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth be acceptable to you. Amen. David knows the Ten Commandments. David knows he's supposed to put God above everything, including his own desires. David knows you're not supposed to steal. You're not supposed to commit adultery. You're not supposed to lie. And you're certainly not supposed to make sure someone gets murdered on the battlefield who didn't need to die. But he has broken all of those. He's broken all those rules. He has put his own desires ahead of God. And he has taken a wife that belongs to one of his soldiers. He has several wives of his own already. In that day and age, you could have more than one wife. And he did. He already had several wives. But Uriah, a soldier in his army, only had one wife. And he took her. And she got pregnant. And then he tried to lie about it. And he tried to cover it up. And finally, he had Uriah, her husband, killed in battle. He did some really awful things. But somehow, David hasn't seen the evil that he has done. Somehow he's hidden from himself that he's done something bad. So God sends Nathan. Now Nathan's a man who's very close to God. He is David's spiritual advisor. He is someone who kind of might be like a personal preacher to David, how we might put it today's language. And David welcomes Nathan into his presence. But Nathan must have known that if he talked to David directly about what he had done, maybe David wouldn't hear it very well. He might get defensive or something. Because he doesn't open by saying, David, you've done wrong. He opens with a made-up story about someone else. And he starts with this, he tells a story of these two men, one who is so poor he only owns one little sheep. And it's like a family member to him. He's treated like a child almost like he would a pet. And there was this rich man who had lots of flocks of birds, and he had lots of herds of animals, and he had plenty to go around. But when someone came who was traveling, who needed to be fed a meal, the rich man didn't want to take one of his animals, even though he had lots of them. He took the poor man's animal and had that one fixed for the dinner, leaving the poor man with none. And the rich man still had all of his. It's not a very nice story, is it? And David was just totally upset by the story that Nathan had told. And he shouts out, oh, how can that man do that? He's had no pity. He deserves to die. And then he says, and he should repay the lamb four times over. He is very upset. He's very upset because a rich man stole something from a poor man. And it wasn't right. And Nathan says, you are that rich man. You have so much. God has given you this kingdom. He protected you from King Saul when he was trying to kill you. He has given you all of Israel and Judah to rule over. And if that had not been enough, he would have given you even more. And yet, you stole another man's wife. David finally sees the evil that he has done and admits it and asks for forgiveness. The psalm that Sandy read earlier is written by David after Nathan comes to him to point out how evil and sinful his actions have been. And he asks God to create a clean heart. And he was forgiven. We were to continue on with the story. We'll find out that God chooses not to kill David for what he has done, but instead forgive him. But what he has done has set a pattern It's not a good path. And he will have children by multiple wives. He's going to favor some over others, and so there's going to be jealousy, and there's going to be strife in his household. He is going to be at war the rest of his life, and his kingdom is going to fail after his son Solomon's rule ends. The kingdom divides in half. Consequences can still happen, even though he was forgiven. So what can we learn from David? We can learn, to some extent, how to use what God has given us to stop us from doing evil, sinful things, as well as teach us to recognize our sins when we commit them. David did not have all the scripture we do, but he did have the Ten Commandments, and as I pointed out to you, he broke at least five of them in these activities. We have those rules too. But how often do we put what we want ahead of what God asks us to do? How often do we lie and call them little white lies, as if there were white lies and not white lies in Scripture? There aren't. How often have we wanted something that was not ours? How often have we broken those commandments ourselves? But the Scripture can help guide us. The Scripture can help us when we reflect on actions we are considering or words we're thinking of saying. We can think about Scripture, the Scripture that we know, and use it for a guide, and use it in a way that will tell us when we are going to go wrong. And we can add to that our prayers. We can pray before we take actions and before we speak. I mentioned this last week that David did not do that. He just acted on impulse and what felt good for him. He followed the motto not of be faithful unto God and love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Instead, he followed Nike's slogan, which is just do it. And he did wrong. So we can add our prayers to the Scripture. Pray before we act or speak. Pause a moment and not speak words that will hurt or harm others, and not act in ways that cause harm to others. But one of the ways, sometimes, like David, we're kind of blind to our own sin that we've already committed, and so we don't ask for forgiveness. We can use Scripture to help us identify our sins, and prayer as well, when we have committed it. One of the telltale signs for us, though, when we have done wrong is when we try to hide what we've done. When we try to pretend it hasn't happened, when we try to cover it up, like David tried to cover up his sin. It's kind of a minor instance, but when I was a kid, and I was in kindergarten, I just got the brilliant idea to cut my own hair. Do you see how curly my hair is? It was a lot curlier then. And I was getting annoyed with all the curls. So I decided to cut my own hair. I knew I wasn't supposed to do that. I'm not even sure I was allowed to use the scissors I was using to cut my hair at that age. But I cut my hair. But I knew it was wrong. So I took all the hair I cut off and I hid it under the cushion of the sofa. Like that was going to hide it. Because as soon as someone saw my head, they knew I cut my hair. I can vaguely remember my mom saying, "What did you do to your hair?" And me saying, "What? I didn't do anything to my hair." Yeah, right. It was 3 days before we took pictures for kindergarten class pictures. So my mom's on the phone making emergency contact with her hairdresser to get my hair shaped up in some way that looked reasonable in time for pictures and for me to go to school. So the other kids didn't just make fun of me because of my hashed haircut. And some of those hairs were really, really short. So it was interesting work. But my kindergarten picture came out okay. All things did come out okay. But because of my actions that were not right, which I knew were not right, that I tried to hide and then I tried to lie about, I broke trust with my parents. And my mother had to go to all this extra work because she had to make an appointment, and then she had to drive me to it and sit through it while my hair got turned right after I had done what was wrong. All those things, when we lie, when we try to cover up, when we make extra work for people that is not necessary if we had done right, all those are signs that we have done something wrong. We need to apologize. We need to ask for forgiveness. Sometimes we might have a spiritual friend like Nathan was to David, to whom we can go and ask, do you think this is the right thing to do? And kind of bounce ideas around when we're facing a difficult situation. But sometimes we do some things on an impulse, and we need those spiritual friends who in love and concern, not in judgment, but in love and concern will say, you know, what you just did was not right. I think you need to try to fix what you've done. I hope everyone has someone like that in their lives. Mine changes all the time as I move around, but I have those people in my life that will say, Ann, I love you, but. We need those people who are connected to God to tell us sometimes when we've done wrong, when we don't see it ourselves. And one of the tools we have in our toolbox, so to speak, one of the things we have that David did not have is Jesus. David did not have Jesus, who taught us about God's kingdom through his words and through his actions, to clearly lay before us how life should work when we love God with all that we are and we love each other as ourselves. Jesus, through his example, showed us that we are to seek out the ones who are lost. We're to love people. We're to help them become part of the community again when they have wandered away on their own or have been pushed there by circumstances. In the days of Jesus, oftentimes that was disease that people couldn't help getting. In our day and age, maybe, you know, personal choice that people have made. But he welcomed them back and he healed their souls and their body. But most of all, Jesus taught that God's kingdom is about love and compassion. It's built on the dignity of all people, that all people should be respected. And David's kingdom was built on a lot of violence, and it was built on a lack of dignity and words given to women repeatedly. He did that. And also those that he did not like. God's kingdom is based on faith and hope and a good shepherd's care for other people. We have those teachings. We have those examples of Jesus' action. We have his word and his vision of God's kingdom that we pray every time we pray the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We have the knowledge of God's kingdom that is so different from an earthly kingdom. David didn't have that advantage. We do. And it should change how we interact, and it should change our decision on how to live and act and speak to one another. As we continue to reflect on the scripture in the hours ahead, at least hopefully we don't walk out of this building totally forgetting what we just heard. as we maybe continue to reflect on this. I pray that we learn to use the tools God has given us to prevent us from doing harmful things and sinful things to begin with, but also to recognize when, as we all do, we will fall short and we will sin, to recognize it and to seek forgiveness and do our best to repair the damage we have done. May our lives live out that hope that I have, that all of us will do better and will be more faithful. In Jesus' name. We turn now to our ministry opportunities and other kind of opportunities. I was given a note at the 8 o'clock service that Rich and Deb Straub are going to be in Orion tomorrow. And they would like to get together with everyone who's available, so they've reserved a pavilion across the street from 3 to 6 o'clock for people to just come by and visit with them, catch up with them. So if you'd like to do that between 3 and 6 tomorrow, they made a note, they're not providing food. You don't get to eat, but you do get to visit and share. For those of you who are Facebook users, those who worship with us online as well as those in person, if you're a Facebook user, we are going to be posting, we've already started, posting things about our Revive 5 events. At this point, there's been nothing come to us. That means we have to change any of those plans. We just need to wear masks when we do them. Those events are coming up starting in 2 weeks, and we want everybody to know as many people know as possible. So if you are a Facebook person, please hit the share button. Go to the Orion United Methodist Church Facebook page, hit the share button, put it on your page as well. That's one of the best ways you can help us advertise. You can be marketing specialists for us by sharing our posts about Revive 5 with your friends and family as well. And speaking of Revive 5, there's a couple things I want to lift up this morning. One is, 2 weeks from today is a Sunday. We're asking everyone to worship at the same time, at the same service. So we're only going to have one Sunday morning service at 9 a.m., and so you need to come early. You need to come earlier that day. But it's going to be followed by a wonderful Easter brunch. You haven't had them for 2 years, so you're going to get one, not at Easter, but for Revive 5. We're going to have an Easter brunch, and the magician's going to be here. We're just going to have a whole lot of fun. He's going to do magic tricks at tables, and then he's going to do a short show after everybody's done eating, and we'll be all done by noon, so it shouldn't make any big changes to your Sunday routine, and so we hope you'll all come and be part of that. But in addition to that, if you turn on your insert to the backside where it has our logo for our Revive 5, at the top, it says COVID memories. We want to decorate the church, our sanctuary in Narthex, with things that remind us of the days of COVID. Now, don't bring masks. We all know we have to wear masks. And, of course, now we're going to be wearing them again for a little while. Hopefully, only a little while. But other things. Things that you can bring pictures to put on the bulletin board. We're going to have an empty chair to represent those people we couldn't see when we couldn't travel freely. And you can put pictures or names on that chair. We are going to have a poster where we're going to name the people who have passed during the days of COVID, whether they died from COVID-related things or not, but the people whose lives we really didn't get to have closure for because of all the COVID restriction. We also are going to ask you to bring in things that that you just think of, something that represents the unusual time of COVID. I'm bringing a movie box because I had moved during COVID and it was very, very odd to do that. Somebody, I think it's Betty Nightingale, is planning to bring an ice cube tray because not knowing how often she could shop when the days of COVID started, she froze milk in the ice cream trays. So she would have milk if she couldn't get out to buy it. So whatever kinds of things remind you of how your life changed during the days of COVID, for good or for maybe not so good, either way, we want you to bring it. We're going to decorate our altar area, we're going to decorate the narthex, and have them here for 5 weeks. For more details, read my column in the newsletter that, if you haven't received it, you should be getting in the next day or two. But that's, we want you to bring those in as soon as possible, so we can get as many out the first week of the Revive 5 as we can. But you are welcome to bring them anytime you think of that. So I think that's all the announcements I need to make this morning. I am going to invite you to stand as we sing the doxology and then share our offertory prayer. Communion together, and you will need the prayer of confession that's in your bulletin, and you will also need your hymnal, as we will be singing our responses in the Great Thanksgiving beginning on page 17. Christ invites everyone to his table who calls him Lord and Savior, who want to repent of their sins and receive forgiveness. And so we enter into a time of prayer, prayer of confession, as we seek forgiveness this day. If you turn in your bulletins or to the comments on our Facebook page. As you have gathered us up in your promises, now make us your people, O God. Show us where our spirits hunger and thirst. We confess we grow too used to doing without the spiritual food that you sent to us in Jesus Christ. Help us to know our need for your grace, no longer fearing what we lack, but desiring what you surely provide. Heal, renew, forgive, and set us free as whole persons in Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, our Alpha and our Omega, whose strong and loving arms encompass the universe, for with your eternal word and Holy Spirit, you are forever one God. Through your word, you created all things and called them good, and in you we live and move and have our being. When we fell into sin, you did not desert us. You made covenant with your people Israel and spoke through prophets and teachers. In Jesus Christ, your word, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead the same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood. As the grain and grapes once dispersed in the fields are now united on this table in bread and juice, so may we and all your people be gathered from every time and place into the unity of your eternal household and feast at your table forever. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now let us join in the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now you may take your bread and cup. The first flip up is a clear flip, and underneath the clear is your wafer, and then the purple flip will give you your juice. We no longer have the plastic bags hanging in the pews, but you can use the cup holders in the pews for setting your cup until service is done. We just ask if you remember to pick them up as you leave and put them in the wastebasket on your way out. Save some cleanup. Let us stand for our closing hymn. Just as I am without one plea, we're going to sing the first four verses only. And now may the God of creation, who gave us so much to live by, so many good gifts and so many graces, and his Son Jesus, who died for our sin, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit, lead you in the ways that lead you to righteous living, faithful living, and to seek forgiveness when needed. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.